I'm usually not up in front of people. I'm usually like hiding in the closet. So if I'm a little nervous looking, it's because I am. But I'm pretty passionate about this. I brought some stuff to show and tell. If you want to come up here after you're done, like, please wash your hands first, because pizza and tiny computers are maybe not the best combination of things. It's actually kind of funny because I'm speaking today at this meetup, and I'm also speaking tomorrow at the Cincy IoT meetup. Both of them are serving pizza and basically soda, and that's like the worst combination of things that a type 1 diabetic could eat. So it's a little bit funny because Amanda's like, what are they going to serve tomorrow? Maybe I'll come. Pizza. Ooh. Yeah, maybe I won't do that one then. So I'm going to give a little bit of background here. Actually, most of the talk is going to be about what type 1 diabetes really is, all the different terms, all the different things that you have to deal with when you're type 1, and then talk a little bit about the computers involved and some of the solutions out there that people have to the insulin delivery and things like that. And then I'm going to get a little bit into JavaScript. I'm not actually going to show any code today. This is really more of a shallow dive into some of the things that I've been very inspired by in a community of developers who write Python, write Swift code, write JavaScript. I mean, there's a lot of things going on in this entire ecosystem that have been happening over maybe 5 or 10 years at this point. So I will get started without further ado. My talk is actually called Type 1 Diabetes and Tiny Computers. I'm going to tailor it a little bit more for the JavaScript audience today. It's really interesting, but when we get into it a little bit, the most fascinating part about this, and I'm going to call attention to it again when we get there, is that the inner loop, the core algorithm that helps people with diabetes is actually written in JavaScript. And that's kind of mind-boggling to me. So anyway, without further ado, let's get moving. This is why I care about it. This is my wife, Amanda. She has had, she's had type 1 diabetes for about 11 years, going on 12. She was previously misdiagnosed as type 2. That's pretty regular. I still kind of remember the day that I was at work, and she called and told me the news, and she was just, you're not ever really ready to hear things like you have this lifelong disease. And so she was crying, and she was very upset, and I didn't know what it meant, and she didn't know what it meant. Her GP, her general physician, is the one who told her that, and he wasn't prepared to give her the right materials. He basically just said, check your sugar. And that's like, nobody even knows what that means when you're getting this news the first time. So that was kind of a shock. It was a dark period for a little while until she went to an endocrinologist and she learned about it. Eventually, I also learned about it, both out of like self-preservation, because if you're married to someone who's type 1, you need to know what they're going through, but also because of the projects that I've been involved with in helping her through that. She's also, actually, we'll get into it in a few minutes, but she's also actually one of only two people that I know in the region who is doing something called closed looping. And we'll talk about that in a little bit, but it's kind of fascinating. There's not a lot of people in this area who are doing this. It's mostly out in like Seattle, a few in California, and then like worldwide there's a few people around. There are over 100 people doing it, so I don't want to make it sound like there's like 12, but really most of them are on the West Coast who are working on this. What is type 1? It is an autoimmune disease. A lot of people have misconceptions about, well, you ate too much sugar as a kid or something like that. It has nothing to do with it. Your pancreas gets attacked by your own immune system so that your beta cells that would otherwise generate insulin no longer function. They're not able to do that. New beta cells aren't able to grow and create the insulin that you need. It used to be called juvenile diabetes. It's not really called that anymore, but it was usually marked by when the onset happened. So if you were, you know, a kid and you got diabetes, you were called juvenile diabetes. If you were an adult, which is actually really more like type 2, you would get it later. But there's also adult onset type 1. So that's where we stopped calling it juvenile diabetes and started calling it type 1. Type 2 is actually different. Type 2 is when your body starts resisting the insulin that it produces. So your pancreas is still making insulin to help blood glucose convert into energy. But your body is basically saying, no, I can't process that insulin anymore. There's nothing you can do about it. Once you have it, you have it. You probably were always going to have it. There are maybe some factors that weigh into it that are like after birth, but mostly it's genetic. There's not a whole lot that you can do to prevent it. There's nothing you can do to get rid of it. There are some really exciting things potentially on the horizon for anybody who has this autoimmune disease, and we'll talk about that thing too. So what affects blood sugar? A lot of people think, well, if you know anything about diabetes, you think, well, it's just blood sugar and it's just insulin delivery and food. Like you have to count carbs and count sugar and figure out, measure yourself with finger pricks and then give yourself insulin, and that's gotta be it, right? It's not true. I mean, everything, and I can vouch for this having a wife who is a type 1, like literally everything throughout the day affects her blood sugar. Hormones, if she's stressed out, last night while she was watching the election, it was actually relatively okay. But like those kinds of events, talking in front of people, one of the people who actually invented the closed loop, her name is Dana Lewis, she showed her blood sugar like meter while she was talking, and it spiked up and it kept spiking and kind of like plateaued, and as soon as she was done, it came back into normal range. So like hormones, everything affects your blood sugar. So it's not just food. A lot of people think that if you have type 1 diabetes that insulin is your cure. It's not really a cure. It's really just the thing that allows you to function. The cure for diabetes, for type 1 diabetes, would be to have a pancreas that functions, or to have something that works closely enough like a pancreas that you don't have to think about it, that you don't have to constantly think about what your blood sugar is and how whatever you're about to do affects that. There's two kinds of insulin delivery. Sometimes it's actually two kinds of insulin. You have the basal and you have the bolus. So the basal rate, if you think about it like a base layer, if you have like a base layer of clothing, this is what a basal insulin is like. It's a constant drip that really just helps the blood sugar that's in your stream be processed. The bolus is actually what you would do during a meal. So like if you were eating pizza, do I need to stop? Is there something going on? Okay. Okay, I'm gonna continue on and then let me know if I need to stop. So the bolus is what you would do during a meal. So if you were gonna eat pizza, pizza is terrible for diabetics, but you would try to like factor in the fats and the different kinds of carbohydrates that are going in, and they all interact badly and they cause you to spike and drop and spike, and that's crazy. So bolusing is basically what you would do, counting carbs, figuring out how it's gonna affect you, guessing, typing a number into your pump or putting some stuff into a syringe and injecting it. The basal is the drip, and basal is basically a rate. It's like a units per hour that's delivered versus bolusing, which is like, here's a big chunk of insulin, go like put it in my bloodstream so I can counteract the blood sugar. Bolusing, if you want to think about it as like a mnemonic, think bowl of food, and basal would be like your base layer, like a base, just the background, the thing that lets you keep functioning. There's a lot of stuff here, but this is basically a day in the life of Amanda. Like wake up, treat a low, treat a high, guess about how much carbs you're doing, probably too many, probably too little. Like it's just this constant like, what am I doing and how is this affecting my blood sugar? She can't just go and have fun and do things without having to think about how it impacts her. And that's painful. For anybody who has like a long-term like disease, you have to factor these things into your life. And it affects people around you, and it affects them in ways that they don't necessarily know is happening. Right, she might be in a bad mood, or on a high. Like she can be very excited or very down, and I don't know why, but it actually could be her blood sugar that's doing this to her. So I've become more aware of that over time. It probably affected our relationship more early on than it does now. I can actually look at her blood glucose numbers before I go home and generally tell whether I'm going to have a good conversation when I get home or if I'm going to have a hard time. And that actually helps me to support her if I know she's been high with her blood sugar all day, that I can take the kids from her and just, you know, she can relax and go do something else. So that's kind of like the day, right? Like you think, I'm just eating food, I'm just going about my business. She's thinking, how many carbs are in this and what's it gonna do to me? So the type 1 diabetes technology that's out there right now, the state of the art really, that's on the market right now, there's two main components. There's this thing called an insulin pump. I have one of them here. If you can imagine this thing with a big tube attached to it and it's connected to your body and you're wearing this in your pocket, this is an insulin pump. This has a little reservoir of insulin in it. It's got a little like auger kind of motor thing that very precisely pushes the right amount of insulin into your body. This can do both bolusing and basaling. So it's constantly giving you a little bit of insulin, and when you tell it, hey, I'm about to eat, it pushes a little bit more into your system, and if you have fast enough acting insulin, then it does its job. There's also something called a continuous glucose monitor. This is the interface for a continuous glucose monitor, but it's also the same kind of thing. It has to be put into your body. So you wear this little transmitter, and it connects up to either a receiver or your phone directly via Bluetooth. There's two main ones on the market right now. Dexcom makes one, and MiniMed makes one. MiniMed's works right with their pump. Dexcom's are like a standalone product, but they integrate with some of the other pumps directly as well. The reason that those two things are important is this. So Medtronic makes the far and away the most popular version. It's not the prettiest, but it's the most popular one. They have on their older pumps a feature that was flagged by security researchers as a problem, and it kind of is a problem, but on their older pumps, you could actually send commands wirelessly to the pump to deliver insulin, both the bolusing and the basal. And I don't know, it was a few years ago, somebody basically did research and said, you could basically send somebody insulin remotely if they're in the same room as you. It's kind of scary. But where one person sees a security flaw, other people see the ability to potentially close a loop of, I have continuous glucose, maybe I can deliver insulin and predict based off of that wirelessly without, you know, any other intervention. So the two, these are the CGMs, a little bit bigger picture of them, and this is the Dexcom device that's called the receiver. You basically wear both. You have a site for your insulin delivery and you have a site for your glucose monitoring, and about every 5 minutes it gives you a new reading and tells you whether you're headed up or down or if you're flat. And that's your blood sugar that it's measuring. So nobody actually said this, but I put it in quotes because it's kind of cool. The idea is that people everywhere were kind of asking this question, like technologists were saying, I have type 1, I have this pump, I have this continuous glucose monitor, why can't I just like put them together and close this loop so I don't have to keep delivering different values of insulin and I can get my blood sugar into control better? And I mean, the answer to that is the loop. You've heard me probably say the term a couple of times. Looping is basically taking, when you're open looping, you're taking the insulin that's going into your body, and then you're measuring what it's doing to your blood glucose. You're probably sending it to a computer, maybe a tiny computer like a Raspberry Pi. I have one of them here, or like an Edison. And you're like analyzing what's happened over the last 30 minutes or so, and you're projecting out what might happen over the next 30 minutes or so. And you're doing the safest thing to get the diabetic person, the patient, in range, in a good blood glucose range. And that's only with the basal rate, not with the bolusing. All the safe approaches that are not FDA approved yet are using the basal rate, which is that drip. They're not trying to like give you big globs of insulin and trying to fix it that way, because that's pretty dangerous to do for a computer to just tell your pump to give you a bunch of insulin. It's adjusting the small rates, like 1 or 2 units per hour, not like 8 or 9 units of one shot. Excuse me. So there's also something called closed looping. And closed looping takes your intervention out of it. Where in the open loop, you have to manually put something into the pump and say, change my basal rate, change the flow that I'm getting of insulin. The closed loop just says, hey, you know what? If I can send a command to the insulin pump to change it automatically, why wouldn't I do that? So this insulin pump talks to the CGM, or not talks to the CGM, but the insulin pump talks to the computer, the CGM talks to the computer, and then the computer determines a predictive like analysis of what's going to happen next, and then tells your pump to change the basal rate based off of that. So as you're going high, it applies downward pressure by giving you more insulin. As you're going low, it cuts off the insulin that's going into you so that you can adjust and come back up. The major like reference implementation, community reference implementation of closed looping is called OpenAPS. It's mostly Python code that talks to the hardware. So if I have Dexcom, there's Python code that talks to the Dexcom. If I have a Medtronic pump, there's something called DecoCare, which is built in Python as well, that reverse engineers the pump communications and the wireless packets that are sent, and then figures out what are my current pump settings, what's my basal rate now, and what should I change it to, and then sends the command to the pump to change that. So all that's written in Python, but most interestingly, the inner loop is written in JavaScript. It's about 400 lines of JavaScript. I think it's called determine basal or something like that. Very non-assuming. You have to go several levels deep into this project to find it. But JavaScript is at the core of hundreds of people walking around closed looping right now. When I first heard that, I was kind of scared because it's math and JavaScript and floating point numbers and like all that stuff's a little scary. It's open source, it's auditable, it's approachable. So if you go and you look at it, you can kind of figure out what it's doing, and that was the whole point. They wanted to be able to say, here's what a closed loop looks like, and here's how we're going to implement it. And JavaScript is a pretty approachable language for that. All of that's cool, but if you look up here, there's not a lot of screens, right? There's no way easily to say, what's going on with me right now if I'm closed looping? And the answer to that is that you need some kind of data visualization tool. You need some way to see what's my current blood glucose, what's being applied to my pump to change that, and what are any other factors that might play into the algorithm that's being used. This is where another JavaScript application comes in. This is called Night Scout. I'm actually gonna close the presentation for a second. You saw this probably when you came in. This is my wife's current blood sugar and what's going on with her insulin pump right now. She's actually at CVG doing a thing with the kids, watching airplanes take off and land and stuff, so that's pretty cool. That's all to say that like she's not here. She's not on this Wi-Fi network. She's not doing anything. She's not at home even, like plugged into something. She's out and about doing stuff. What you see up here that looks kind of like a cityscape is actually her basal rate adjustment that's going on. You see this 2.25 units. That's the maximum basal rate that her pump is set to allow right now. When it's all the way down here, it's at zero. So if you follow the curve of her blood sugar readings, each dot is about 5 minutes, and you can kind of see what the algorithm is doing. As she goes high, it's like, hey, whoa, whoa, okay, more insulin, let's bring it down. And as she goes low, you can see it basically drop down to zero sometimes if it predicts that she's gonna go low. And I'll kind of show you a little bit of that prediction really quick. So you can go backward in time and basically figure out what happened at some point. It'll show you like what was going on at that point with all of the different variables. Up on the top left here, you'll see, it says retro here, but it'll tell you when the last loop was, what your pump unit reservoir has left, how many volts are going through the pump right now, like the battery status. It'll look back a certain number of hours. Over on this side, it'll basically tell you what your blood sugar is and what it's doing, if it's going down or up. It'll tell you the insulin that you have on board, which is how much insulin you have in your body that's being effective, and how many carbs you have in your system as well. So there's a lot of things going on with these algorithms that are trying to help figure out what's gonna happen next and react to essentially future events that it perceives are gonna be a thing. Does anybody have any questions yet? Is this cool? This isn't really all that much JavaScript yet, but it's an entire Node application. So the architecture of Night Scout is, it's open source, it's built in Node, it's an Express server with a Mongo backend. It has a web component, there's mobile apps that are essentially Cordova wrappers over it. It has Pebble watch face support, there's Apple Watch stuff out there for it. There's all kinds of APIs as far as like Dexcoms and Medtronic to like upload data into the system so that you can see it. All of that stuff is up here. It's called CGM Remote Monitor. If you have questions about this afterward, I have all the links. I mean, I've done so much work in this so far, so like I can tell you more than you need to know, and I probably already am. The support for devices is ridiculous. Like, I know you're not gonna be able to read all that, but these are all the different devices and all the different ways that you can view the data from the things that are going into Night Scout. So this is all JavaScript. Like the whole application architecture, including the data in the back end, is like Mongo. I mean, that's kind of crazy to me. So what's my role in this huge community of people and different projects and everything? It's pretty minimal. I've built some rigs. These things, everybody in the OpenAPS community calls these rigs. These are the computers that do the looping. You can do it with a Raspberry Pi and like a special little radio that you attach to it. You can do the same thing with an Edison that has a battery on it. This will last for about a day, so you can loop for about a day. And then you have to recharge it, but it can recharge on the fly, so you just plug it in every night. It started out with this little USB CareLink stick. They reverse engineered all the pump communications from this, figured out what chip the pump was using, built some things for that, and they just keep iterating on it. So there's a lot of hardware stuff involved as well. I have deployed Night Scout a number of times. I kind of get how it works now. Never done a Node application before, never really managed Mongo. That's all like kind of learn on the fly kind of stuff. I've read quite a bit of the JavaScript loop, the 400 lines. There's a lot going on there, just to help Amanda with any questions that she has. Like, hey, I went high, but it didn't give me enough insulin. Why was that? What did it think was going on? and trying to help her with those questions. probably the most significant contribution was not actually in the JavaScript or Python code. I sort of reverse engineered the reverse engineered Python code and wrote the Swift code for an iOS application that decodes on older pumps, decodes the CGM data from them. So the Dex, not the Dexcom, the Medtronic old CGM data. That was a pretty significant effort. I finished it over a couple of weeks. Didn't write any Swift code before that, so it was kind of like I didn't know how to read Python, I didn't know how to write Swift, and I didn't know what data I was looking at. So it was kind of like a worst case scenario, but it was pretty fun to do, and it seems like it worked out okay so far. So I guess the most important thing is that I'm here telling you about it. As far as I know, there's only two people in the area that are closed looping. One is my wife, and one is another close friend. I know there's a lot of people with type 1 diabetes. So, I mean, there's opportunities here for this community to be built up around it if people are interested in that. If you know people who are impacted by type 1 diabetes and you're interested in any of this, I am probably the touch point for you right now in Cincinnati. So you could talk to me about that. As far as hardware is concerned, the opportunities for you to contribute would be like Python, JavaScript, Night Scout's written in JavaScript, Loop is an iOS Swift app that does very similar things. My wife is actually running on Loop right now, not on OpenAPS. On the hardware side, there's this thing called Riley Link, which bridges the pump to an iPhone or to an Android phone. There's an Explorer board, which is basically, if you come up and look at this afterward, you'll see a hodgepodge of soldering that was pretty terrible, and I did all that. The Explorer board is like the commercial version of that. They're going to be selling it through one of the major like hardware vendors or something like that, but it's basically this, but better. And that will run in Edison, and you can run OpenAPS and Linux and everything on that. And then 3D printed cases. Everything needs a 3D printed case. I don't have many up here, but everybody gets really excited about that for some reason. So what's next? This is probably the most interesting and least known kind of part of all of this. There are only a limited number of pumps left that can be hacked to Loop. This pump in particular can't. This is too new. They don't let you adjust the basal rate via wireless communication. So there's only really a market left of so many pumps that you can actually do this looping on. The OREF0 implementation, that JavaScript implementation, is designed to serve as a reference, so if anybody's trying to build a commercial product, they can look at the open implementation of this and get a starting point. They're hoping that that will be sort of the going forward touch point for the community. I don't know if you've heard recently, I don't know how much in the news this was because I follow different circles because of this stuff, but the FDA just approved a closed loop insulin pump for Medtronic. That's gonna be coming to the market next year. I think it's called the 760G or something like that. But basically anybody who's got diabetes can set their rate or set their target range to be 120, and it will do basically similar things to what OpenAPS does commercially. You don't have to think about it as much. You're not setting up a Linux installation to do a closed loop. And there are other closed loop products. I think Bigfoot Biomedical is one of them. There's a few others that are actually building closed loop products, and they're in trial right now. I will say that it's probably a result of these two things, that these two things have happened as quickly as they have. It's been decades that people said, closed loops are coming, closed loops are coming. And then when we actually built one as a community, then they actually started approving them. So I have a feeling that the influence of the top two is pretty strong on the bottom two there. What's not up here is the possibility of a cure. There's really interesting stuff going on, and I've also been reading about that. One of the most crazy things that they've been talking about recently is that they're growing these beta cells in like a test lab, and then they're surrounding them with a film of algae and implanting them into, I think it's mice right now, and the autoimmune cells, the autoimmune disease is not attacking it because the algae's there, and so these beta cells can last for like 6 months or something like that. And basically you have a pancreas that functions for about 6 months and then you go get another implant. So who knows where that's going? Who knows where any of this other research is happening, is going? Hopefully everything I just showed you is obsolete and they just find a cure. We're not really hinging on that hope, but it would be pretty neat if that happened. So what questions do you have? That's basically all I have for the talk. I know that I glossed over a lot of things because I talked about a lot of things. What do you have?
What's the power goal sort of part of the year? Is that sort of like a future prediction of what
Oh, yeah. This is the loop, the iOS app's prediction. There's other kinds that are out there. Most of them show like a spread of where it thinks you could go high and thinks you could go low. Yeah, this is totally a prediction. Anything past this line is where it thinks you're going to head. It's using some kind of crazy reverse decay algorithm thing. So it's looking back so far and saying, based off of what's going on back there, as well as your carbs on board and all this other stuff, what do I think you're going to do in the future? So that's where those lines come from. I don't know how in the world you get that. And it's probably not exactly accurate, but that's what it's making its decisions on. Ben, did you have something? Oh, you stepped up. Oh. Yeah, the OpenAPS code is on GitHub. Night Scout is on GitHub. Everything's on GitHub.
And that's deployed on the board, on the computers, right?
OpenAPS, you run it on top of Linux mostly. It's Python code to communicate with hardware and JavaScript to communicate and do the loop. Like, it takes the inputs from the Python that outputs to these JSON files and then basically combines all that information together to predict and then control. The Riley link is something that this guy named Pete built for his daughter Riley. That's why it's called that. It's a bridge device that does Bluetooth low energy communication and pump communication, and it just bridges the two together. So there's you can build an Android app for it, and there is one, I believe. I'm not 100% sure on that. The details are less clear to me. I know the iOS side pretty well.
So I was kind of curious, like, how you felt about, like, writing code that was affecting someone's life.
Yeah, that's a very personal thing. I feel very responsible for the loop that's running with Amanda right now. I would not have done this. There's no way I would have said, hey, Amanda, let's do this thing with you. You want to be, like, in a test lab, basically. You want to be, like, a guinea pig for this stuff. I would not have done that. She came to me once, and I said no. She came to me again, and I said, let's think about this for a little bit longer and come back if you really want to do it. I didn't even look at the code at that point. It wasn't until she came back and said, I really want to do this, that I started digging in. It took a few weeks to really understand the ecosystem. There's a lot of things at play here, right? And it was really after that I started looking into the safety guards and the fact that it only does basal adjustments, and there's a lot of low cutoffs. The real danger in diabetics, not just loop diabetics, but everybody, is that when you go low, there's an imminent threat, right? When you go too low, you pass out. There's nothing you can do to control that. When you go high, you might be angry. You might have, like, mood changes. You might feel miserable. The long-term effects of being high are pretty bad, but you can correct for those things in the short term. When you go low and you're not able to function, those are the scary parts. And there's quite a bit built into OpenAPS and into Loop that keep you there. In fact, it's actually safer in the sense that when you're in the middle of the night and you're going low, you're not adjusting your basal rate, but it is. It's cutting it off for you. So as you go low, it's like, whoa, let's get you back to a good point. I have some scary stories about Amanda going low in the middle of the night, and that I don't want to relive that again. So yes, I feel personally responsible for her looping, and at the same time, I feel like it's a little bit safer for her. She is entering that as she's eating. One of the features of the Loop app, which I haven't talked about really, is that you can actually tell it what kind of carbs they are as well. So different carbs affect you differently. There's fast-acting carbs and there's slow carbs. So I don't know what she's eating. It doesn't say what she's eating, but she's entering that in through the app, saying, these are the carbs that I'm about to eat, deliver this much insulin. And you can see those things here, right? So she said, I ate 50 grams of carbs. I took 8.2 units of insulin for that. So she ate food right here. This is probably a correction, although it does say 50 grams, so she's probably, like, having dessert or something. So.
I think I know somebody who might actually be interested in this. I think he also has a type 1 diabetes. So what do you think are the, I'm fairly certain he's interested in this, so what do you think are the steps that I should take to maybe talking about this?
Come see me after this. There's a few Gitter chats that are very active and will help you. Basically, people getting started go there first. They read about OpenAPS, they go there. They find out if that's what they want or the Riley link, and they do the Loop app. But I'm more than happy to help facilitate all of that if you want. Yeah, I've kind of wondered about that. Diabetes is interesting because the insulin that we use today isn't anything like it, but it was first really discovered in like 1929 or something. Before that, diabetes was kind of like a death sentence. It might have been slower, but it was pretty bad. When we discovered insulin and started producing it commercially from like pig rDNA and all that stuff, I think, that's really when we started giving a better prognosis to people. Diabetes is a very measurable and reactive kind of a disease. I don't know the answer to your question, but I know that like constant updates of your glucose and the ability to adjust that with insulin pretty quickly is important for this kind of a problem. So I don't know what other diseases have that kind of a situation set up.
Yeah, I couldn't think of one offhand.
Yeah, right.
You said one of the persons in the region is doing something like this?
They're both related to me setting it up for them. There are a lot of people using Night Scout, though. This wasn't actually created for loopers. This was created for parents who wanted to know what was going on with their kids at school. And so you can actually call the school and say, hey, my kid's going high. Like, fix this. Like, can you help it? Or they're gonna misbehave until this is in under control. Like, there's a lot of things that you can do with this information as a parent of a kid with type 1. So, yeah, there's a lot of Night Scout users. I don't think there's many loopers.
If the two diabetes loopers.
Yeah. What do you mean by my thing? One of them is using OpenAPS and one of them is using the Loop app. I'm working on the functionality to support the Loop app for the other person. That's the CGM page data. It's not done yet. I'm mostly through the hard part of it, but now it's integrating it with the Loop. Yeah. Anything else? I don't know. I have ideas. I have thoughts. My thoughts are basically that there's a lot of risk and not a lot of reward for that. The risk is, oops, we made a closed loop and it hurt somebody. Somebody's going to have a problem. And it may or may not be related to the closed loop, but it may get bad press, right? So Medtronic didn't have a lot of rewards there. There wasn't a lot of upshot for that. But with the FDA basically saying, let's do this, and them saying, let's do this, and people already doing it in the community, I think that was part of the push that made that all happen. I don't know if that's true, but that's my thought. Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, the Raspberry Pi 3, even though it's an energy hog, a $30 computer that can do this stuff is pretty amazing.
Well, 10 years ago, you couldn't carry a Linux computer.
Right. And in fact, the Raspberry Pi Zero, I don't have one up here. The other person was looping on a Raspberry Pi Zero. That's a dollar computer. I mean, like, the food you're eating every meal costs more than the computer that's looping for you. That's crazy. So, yeah. All right, any other questions? If you want to come up and have a look at this stuff or ask me other questions up here, that's cool. Thanks for your time. I appreciate it.